The sizzling weather in the Philippines has also affected small businesses. As Lady Vicenza tells us, the heat has caused a 50% drop in their income.
With public schools shifting to online learning and rising temperatures, small businesses are bearing the brunt. This shop in front of Kamuning Elementary School in Quezon City sells school supplies and snack items for kids. On normal days, the shop generates around 1,000 pesos from sales. But for the past weeks, it couldn't even reach half of that amount.
Ibandaan nga, wala nga eh. Kawawa rin naman kasi sa mga bata, eh talagang napakainit. Aswerte nga lang kami, hindi kami umuupa. Pag umuupa kami, patay. Talaga wala kami kinikita.
Learning materials and toys sold in front of Rojas Elementary School are also gathering dust. This shop offers printing services for students' assignments and projects, but those too have been put on hold.
Sinong bibili sa'yo? Walang estudyante. Malaking impact talaga sa negosyo. Malaki. Lalo na sa aming mga maliliit na negosyante. Dito po sa amin, alas 70 to 80%. O ang mawawala sa'yo kasi mga estudyante lang ang ano mo, ang mga inaasahan mong magiging customer mo dito.
Businesses selling food items are also feeling the impact of class suspensions due to extreme heat. Leonora, a fishbowl vendor, lost around 4,000 pesos worth of frozen goods and eggs. Even if stored in a freezer, her products have exceeded their shelf life since she was not able to sell them.
Binili ko yan nung ano eh, akala ko may ano pa, may pasok pa nung buwan ng March katapusan. Hindi naman namin alam na magtuloy-tuloy na kapamilya ako ng marami para hindi na ako bili ng bili. Kaso wala, ito nga walang pasok, yun, walang, hindi pwedeng nailabas, hindi, kasi wala namang mamimili, walang katao-tao.
Even businesses outside the vicinity of schools are experiencing lower sales.
Minsan walang tao, tanghali kasi masyado matumak, simpi may.
Transport workers like TNVS riders are also seeing less bookings between 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. due to the extreme heat.
Pati mga rider na mamahinga, kinukuha ko ma'am, binabiyahe ko yan. Ipapahinga ko na lang, maaga na lang ako uuwi. May baon tubig. Medyo ano eh, kaya nga dati pag ano, kukuntil, 2 litro lang yung baon ko. Ngayon 3 litro na, minsan nakakabili pa ako niyan. Kinukulang pa.
While business owners say they empathize with students who experience challenging conditions when going to school, some are hoping that plans to shift the school calendar will be revisited. But for now, entrepreneurs like them have no choice but to wait for classes to resume and for temperatures to cool down. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Science and Technology Department clarifies the country is not yet experiencing a heat wave despite the extreme hot weather. Secretary Renato Solidum Jr. explains a heat wave happens when the country's temperature exceeds the average maximum temperature by 5 degrees Celsius for 3 to 5 consecutive days. He adds, tropical countries like the Philippines rarely experience heat waves.
Usually, nangyayari ang heat wave sa mga temperate countries, yung malabig na, nabiglang tataas ang temperatura at nagtatagal ng mga ilang araw o linggo. Kaya, kung mapapansin nyo, talagang dahan-dahang uminit ang panahon sa Pilipinas, pero hindi pa ito talaga nalalagpasan ang normal maximum temperature. Dahil ang Pilipinas ay lubhang mainit na, hindi usually tayo nag-i-exceed ng more than 5 degrees for more than 5 days. So, kung mapapansin nyo, hindi ginagamit pa dito ng pag-asa ang terminolohiyang heat wave.
Solidum also urging government to build desalination facilities and use alternative sources of energy to avoid water and power shortages amid the El Nino phenomenon.
Kailangan pa ng mas maraming water impounding structures o mga dams. Sa DOST naman kasi ang gusto namin ay magkaroon tayo ng mas maraming desalination plant na makakakuha tayo ng tubig sa dagat. Nagde-develop tayo through research ng desalination machine na sana ay mas mura. No? Magawa natin mas mura kaysa sa imported. Siyempre, kailangan din ng power source na kailangan solarize ang ating mga mga desalination plants. And it would also be good kung pagdating sa tubig kasi, mayroon ding tubig na kinukuha para sa energy production. So kailangan siguro mas maganda yung kayang magpa-solarize, kung kaya nilang magpalagay ng mga solar photovoltaic cell, yung mga panel sa kanilang mga bubong, ay mag-contribute po tayo doon kasi unang-una in the long term, makakatipid tayo sa kuryente, makakatulong pa tayo sa buong komunidad.
The Philippine Health Insurer is now offering a benefit package for members who may suffer from heat-related illnesses caused by the extreme hot weather. Joyce Balancho with the details.
Cynthia Canave is a real estate agent and part of her work is manning their booth for 8 hours every day. It might look easy, but she says the hot weather makes it hard for her to finish her shift.
Kanina, bumunta ako ng CR kasi parang pareho kami ni Kuya, yung kasama ko na nakaguti. Sabi namin parang nahihilo kami. Pero ginawa namin, nagdrink kami ng tubig, tapos nagpahinga ako saglit sa loob, medyo malamig. Okay na.
Cynthia welcomes the PhilHealth's announcement. It is now offering benefits package for patients who experience heat stroke and heat exhaustion.
Yung mga kababayan natin na ma-admit, kailangan po ma-hospitalize, no? Due to heat stroke or heat exhaustion, sila po ay merong benefit, no, from PhilHealth. At ito po ay 8,450.
The Department of Labor and Employment proposes to review this package as a member of the PhilHealth Board. Labor Secretary Bienvenido Laguesma says it should cover even outpatient services.
Kailangan siguro din ay medyo maintindihan na magkaroon ng konting siguro flexibility in a sense. Kasi kung kailangan eh, ma-confine ka pa bago ka magkaroon ng availment. Wala namang gustong ma-confine. Siguro patitignan natin na din baka pwede pang magkaroon ng improvement yung guidelines to be able to avail.
Dole also advises employers to support their employees' well-being by allowing them to take a leave of absence on days when extreme heat causes them to get sick.
Sa ating pong mga employers, kung perong meron pong mga available naman na leaves, mga may available na mga medical assistance na pwedeng may pagkaloob sa kanila, eh siguro dapat huwag natin itong ipagkait sa kanila. Ay baka pwedeng yung mga pagtatrabaho, i-adjust ang oras. No? Huwag sa masyadong kainitan. Ang panawagan ko naman sa mga manggagawa, sa atin pong mga manggagawa, huwag din namang abusuhin.
The Civil Service Commission also says that government employees are entitled to sick leaves if they experience heat-related illnesses or injuries.
Pwede sa gobyerno po, no? Ang available natin ay ang sick leave ng mga empleyado if you are suffering from heat stroke. Kung ang sick leave po ay mag-exceed ng 5 days, kailangan na ho ang medical certificate nito. So sa mga employees na ma-confine sa hospital due to complications ng heat stroke, at mag-a-avail ng PhilHealth benefits, kailangan pong mag-comply tayo sa lahat ng requirements.
They can also avail the rehabilitation leave.
Kung ang isang employee ay field worker or traffic enforcer, laborers na nakaranas ng heat stroke, ay natumba at nagkasugat or na-fracture ang paa or kamay as a result, pwede po siyang mag-avail ng rehabilitation leave based sa advice ng doktor. Ang maximum po ng rehabilitation leave po ay 6 months.
Employees who died or suffered injuries due to the performance of work may also avail of benefits under the Employees' Compensation Program. This also covers those working from home.
Not only for the government sector but as well for the private sector po. Ang kinakailangan po dito, meron lang kayong directive or order from your employer requiring a work from home arrangement or the performance of a specific task within a specified period at the residence or dwelling place of the employee.
The Department of Health notes that from January to April this year, there have been 77 cases of heat-related illnesses recorded nationwide. 7 deaths related to the effects of extreme heat have been recorded, with 1 still under verification.
Most of their causes of death are what we call heat influenced. Ibig sabihin, yung iba sa kanila nagkaroon ng stroke, putok na ugat sa utak, hindi yung heat stroke ha, yung iba sa kanila nag-atake sa puso. Dahil sa init ng panahon ay yung mga kunyari, yung alta presyon ay lumalala, nagkakaroon ng trigger at nagiging ganyan yung resulta.
The DOH is also advising the public to be aware and cautious of their health conditions which may worsen because of the hot weather.
Hypertension, hindi lahat ng tao alam na may high blood sila. Tawag nga namin dyan silent killer. Ang recommendation dyan is, well, lalo na ngayong mainit, pero kahit hindi mainit, dapat ideally once a day kung meron kayong pang blood pressure sa bahay, no, take your blood pressure, magpaturo po sa doktor or sa nurse kung paano kumuha ng blood pressure para alam nyo po kung normal o hindi ang blood pressure.
Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
A political analyst weighs in on the growing tensions between the camps of the Marcoses and the Dutertes. Ronald Llamas believes the so-called unity team is not solid to begin with due to lack of platforms, principles, and even friendship. He adds the tensions between the families of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. and his predecessor Rodrigo Duterte will continue to rise as they are yet to face off in the 2028 presidential polls.
As early as 2022 and 2023 ay nag-unravel o nawasak yung unity team primarily because of 2028 na malayo pa yung election kakaugnay itong mga issues na ito, confidential fund, ICC, no, foreign policy vis-a-vis West Philippine Sea, nag-ugnay-ugnay na siya para talagang sumabog yung unity team. Ito ay napaka-defining na labanan. Ito ay open warfare na eh. Diba? Lahat ng kakampi ng mga Marcos, lahat ng kakampi ng Duterte ay kasama na doon sa bakbakan.
Aside from power ambitions, Llamas believes the Dutertes and Marcoses are fighting to keep their relevance in the political sphere. The two camps have been throwing slurs against each other, with former President Duterte calling Marcos a weak leader who uses drugs. The House, under the leadership of the President's cousin, House Speaker Martin Romualdez, meanwhile stripped Vice President Sara Duterte of confidential funds.
Ang sabi ni Senator Trillanes ay parating this year yung International Criminal Court para mag-issue ng international warrant. Kung yan ay totoo, then ito ay hindi lamang labanan sa mga ambisyon. Ito ay labanan sa very existence ng mga Duterte at to some extent ng mga Marcos. So nagiging existential battle siya, no? Dahil kung sakaling darating yung ICC at papayagan ng gobyerno na i-implement yung international warrant, talagang mawawala yung mga Duterte, no? At kasama yung kanilang mga kaalyado. Kung totoo yung mga banat ng mga Duterte sa Marcos, katulad nung unang Davao Rally, na tinreten si Bongbong Marcos ng insurrection, sedition, mutiny, coup d'etat, secession, even a hint of assassination, mismo si President Bongbong Marcos ay nanganganib.
Manila malls filing another diplomatic protest against Beijing following its latest water cannon attack. Tuesday's harassment caused damage to a Philippine Coast Guard vessel escorting a resupply mission to Filipino fishermen in Scarborough Shoal. The water cannon attack also hit the Philippine flag, earning the ire of Filipino Coast Guard officials. The PCG says China's actions are no longer gray zone tactics, but an outright violation of international law that put lives in danger.
China is just violating the international law, and they are blatant offenders of the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea. They don't also care about the IMO conventions. As far as our government is concerned, wala nang gray zone strategy ang China. For us, all of their actions that they're doing there are just basically unlawful actions, and they are offenders of the international law. Definitely, no? Ang for viewers, ordinaryong tao na makikita na ang bandila natin tinitira ng water cannon, ito talaga napakasakit sa atin bilang Pilipino.
Amid China's growing aggression, the Philippines is ramping up defense ties with allies. The defense ministers of the U.S., Japan, Australia, and the Philippines meet in Hawaii for their second quadrilateral meeting Thursday. U.S. Defense Chief Lloyd Austin also condemning Beijing's attack.
Filipino crews are put in danger, where troops, sailors have been injured, and property damage. That's irresponsible behavior, and it disregards international law. You've heard me say, you've heard our president say a number of times that our commitment to the treaty is ironclad, and we stand with the Philippines.
Taiwan's defense ministry said Friday it detected 26 Chinese aircraft and 5 naval vessels around the self-ruled island in the past 24 hours. Defense ministry said 17 of the aircraft crossed the median line and entered Taiwan's northern and central air defense identification zone. This comes weeks before the May 20 inauguration of new Taiwan President Lai Ching-te, whom China regards as a dangerous separatist. Beijing claims democratic Taiwan as part of its territory and has never ruled out the use of force to bring the island under its control. The U.S. Indo-Pacific Command has a new commander. During the change of command ceremony held at the Pearl Harbor in Hawaii, the newly installed commander vowed to respond to China's intrusion in the region. Our correspondent Jervis Manahan joins us on the line for more. Jervis.
Yes, Rika, the newly installed commander of the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command vowed to answer China's intrusion in the region amidst increasing tension in the West Philippine Sea. In the change of command ceremony held in Pearl Harbor in Honolulu, Hawaii on Friday, U.S. time, Admiral Samuel Paparo committed to action all challenges that threaten the goals required to achieve mission success. He said that our world faces a complex problem set in the coping actions of China and its rapid buildup of forces. He also added that the Indo-PACOM must be ready to answer PRC's increasingly inclusive and expansionist claims in the Indo-Pacific region. Paparo assumed the role on Friday morning U.S. time after the retirement of Commander Don Aquino, who held the position since 2021. The U.S. Indo-Pacific Command is the unified combatant command responsible for the Indo-Pacific region and is one of the 6 geographic combatant commands defined by the Department of Defense's Unified Command Plan. Paparo added that they will safeguard the international order characterized by transparency, cooperation, fair competition, and the rule of law. In the same ceremony, U.S. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin III reaffirmed their commitment to their allies, saying they are working with their allies like never before. Austin said that in the Philippines, they have expanded U.S. access to 4 new sites under the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement. He also said that China's actions in the region remain as a big challenge. Our Philippine Commander-in-Chief of the AFP, Romeo Browner, attended the change of command ceremony to represent the Philippines. Austin also met with Philippine Defense Secretary Gilbert Yodoro to discuss how the United States will continue to stand with the Philippines. Reporting from Honolulu, Hawaii, this is Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News. Back to you, Rika.
Thank you so much, Jervis Manahan, reporting live. The Philippines falls in the World Press Freedom Index. That's as journalists continue to face challenges as the Philippines remains one of the most dangerous countries for media personnel. Sharian Torres reports.
A communication class in Manila scrutinized the issue of press freedom in the Philippines on Friday, which incidentally also falls on the 31st World Press Freedom Day. Journalism professor Liana Barro says she decided to include in her lectures the widening disinformation and artificial intelligence use issues to equip the youth in combating the problems, given that majority of them are in social media.
Itong deepfake ang laking problema niyan. Ang problema natin dyan, ako ha, lagi ko sinasabi sa mga estudyante ko, do not refuse it, do not resist it. It's the wave of the future, know it. Mm-hmm. Kasi yung AI, it will be there eh. Yan na yung galawan in the near future eh. Alamin mo kung saan ka papasok.
But what suddenly she notes is that today, fewer students want to be journalists.
Mostly kasi discouragement eh from a lot of people eh. Oh, magjo-journalist ka, oh, mapapatay ka, oh, mare-red tag ka.
College lecturer Ramir Simbahon, a former radio program producer, also teaches his students how to prevent misinformation.
Ang lagi kong tinuturo sa kanila ay lagi pong mag-triangulate ng source. Ayan, huwag lamang mag-depend sa iisang source ng information. And ang pinakamahalaga din po doon ay alamin nila sino ba yung nagpapatakbo ng nasabing organization.
These 2 communication students admit becoming a journalist these days is challenging due to the many threats confronting the profession. but they are ready to face the challenges.
It's a calling for me na to tell the truth and also spread accurate information about it and also to avoid disinformation.
Journalism is really not an easy task and we should not demean the meaning of journalism in the country po.
In 2022, then radio commentator Darcy de Galicia was barraged by a local executive in Quezon with 941 counts of libel for criticizing the officials' style of governance in their province. These cases against de Galicia and four others were eventually dismissed. Still, he admits the pressure was too much to bear.
Sabi nga ng ating mga colleagues and fellow journalists, pang Guinness World Record ito kasi hindi siya pangkaraniwang kaso.
The Reporters Without Borders released its 2024 World Freedom Index, Journalism Under Political Pressure, which placed the Philippines 134th out of the 180 surveyed countries on their level of press freedom. With two journalists murdered in the Philippines last year, the group categorized the Philippines still as one of the Asia-Pacific region's most dangerous countries for media professionals. The National Union of Journalists in the Philippines in the PCIJ's third investigative journalism conference meanwhile reported a total of 118 incidents of attacks to journalists from June 2016 to March 2023. Around 50 journalists in the country are also facing libel or cyber libel cases. Despite all these, Filipino journalists here say they are here to stay.
Kahit sandamakmak yung magpanggap na journalist, lilitaw at lilitaw kung sino yung totoo. Because of the practice of journalism, di ba? Sabi nga lagi sa school, the essence of journalism is verification. Kung ikaw naglalabas ka ng tamang impormasyon, vetted, fair, accurate, then kahit maraming nagpapanggap at kiniklaim na journalist sila o ang daming naninira, lalabas at lalabas yung totoo.
I want to believe that we are slowly regaining the trust of the public and we have to continue doing that. Kasi hindi naman natin kayang tayo lang eh. Yes, I think journalism will continue to be relevant, especially in the time of disinformation and misinformation.
Press freedom is also equivalent to the right of every individual to speak about the government and public servants. It is a right that should not be taken for granted, but should be promoted and protected. Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
A Philippine senator suspects a violation of protocols in the alleged collusion of medical doctors with drug firms in prescribing branded medicines. Senator J.V. Ejercito described the proposed scheme as alarming and stressed the urgency to put a stop to the malpractice. He was referring to reports that a pharmaceutical distributor is offering huge incentives to doctors to market its products. Ejercito also believes medical organizations have a role to play in preventing the supposed practice. The vice chair of the Senate Committee on Health is among the authors of the 2019 Universal Healthcare Law, which ensures equitable access to quality healthcare.
Kapag pasyente ka, susunod ka talaga kapag doktor po ang nag-prescribe. So, tingin namin, ito yung violation ng protocol and may conflict of interest po dito. Dahil ang kailangan ang mga doktor, ang scheme po nila ay kung anong general welfare, kung paano makakamura, makakagaan, lalo-lalo na sa mga pasyente.
Fuel prices expected to fall for a second straight week. Estimates show a liter of gasoline would be cheaper by up to 90 centavos. As for diesel and kerosene, their prices could go down by up to 1 peso and 10 centavos per liter.